a good job, the band without me. Well, the song Emily was released in April of 1970. Don't tell me this microphone's not. I think it's going to be okay. Hey, we tested it before the service. It's been not working quite right lately. Anyway, We Are Family was released in... Let's try a different one, Wally. Is it going to bother you because you can see the wireless, the microphone? Nah, there's nothing going on. Try to make it where it won't come unplugged again. I had a really dynamic introduction to my talk. It wasn't that good today, actually. The song that we just heard, We Are Family, was released in April of 1979 and immediately gained traction. People loved it right off the bat, and it was played everywhere, and eventually... it made the list of Billboard's 100 Greatest Girl Group Songs of All Time. It was performed by four sisters whose last name was Sledge, thus the name Sister Sledge. Now, those of us who grew up in the 60s can immediately recite the names of the Beatles, John, Paul, George, and Ringo, in that order. That's the way it's always said, right? Can anyone here name even one of the Sledge sisters' names? You guys are just total guessing. Diana, Thelma, is that what you say? They were Debbie, Joni, Kim, and it was a 19-year-old Kathy who sang the lead vocals on that song, We Are Family. Well, we're in a series called Behind the Music, and we're looking at some of the best-known songs that many of us have listened to all of our lives. And we're delving into what God's Word, the Bible, has to say about the messages of those songs, because we hear them over and over and over, and they kind of get in our subconscious. And we're going to say, what does the Bible have to say about them? Now, I don't have to tell anybody here that the family is in big trouble in our society these days. Fewer and fewer younger people are getting married. The ones who do, fewer and fewer are having children or having very many children. Of course, we've all heard the statistic that 50%+ of all marriages in our country end in divorce. Millions and millions of kids are growing up in single-parent families, most of them without a father there. Fewer families and children are going to church. And most families are spread out, living in different cities, different states, even in different countries where they don't see each other often. And, of course, a lot of families just don't get along that well, some to the point of rarely speaking to each other or seeing each other. So fragmented families have become the norm in our society. And so many people are looking elsewhere to find a sense of community, a sense of family, a sense of belonging, you know, a place. We all kind of have that internally, that longing to connect with other people. And so people are joining like art classes, biker clubs, fraternities and sororities, bowling leagues, sports fantasy leagues, all these kinds of things. And they also go to bars and gyms, yoga class, Zumba class? I don't even know what it is. Concerts. Because within all of us is this desire, this need to be connected to other people. And if people don't find that sense of community, that sense of belonging, that sense of support from their families, more and more people these days are seeking it out in other ways. Even the most introverted among us has a need for connection. Now, in previous times throughout history, like from the 1600s back, most people were born, lived, and died, and maybe never traveled more than 5 or 10 miles from the place where they were born and grew up, right? There was just no form of transportation, and most people didn't. Primitive tribes were made up of families, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, parents, many, many siblings, and they all lived in very close proximity to each other. And so that family was there. It was their community. They were just raised in it. This is still the case, for instance, with some Amish people. You know, maybe their great-great-grandparents settled on 20 acres of land, and they raised their families there. And then the next generation, then the next generation, and they all lived and built houses on that same, like, 20 acres of land. And they worked together, and they ate their meals together. And when they got married, the whole Amish community would pitch in and help build you a home nearby the home that you grew up in and maybe where your parents and some siblings still live. And so you would see and work with and interact with and eat meals with your family every single day. Some of you are like, I'm not so sure I want to live that close or interact that often with some members of my family. So there's a downside too. But there is such a thing as too much community, you know. But we're wired up, we are drawn to, most of us, to have a connection with other people, a sense of community, a sense of family. Life just doesn't really work the way God designed it to if we don't have at least a few really meaningful, loving, positive connections with other people. But what a lot of people don't know or maybe have never experienced is that that is what God designed the church to be. To be a place where people could find a sense of connection, that feeling of belonging, that sense of family that, at least now in our culture, so many people are missing. And they can find some of that. You know, maybe in your case, maybe much of your family, if you're older, maybe a lot of your family members have passed away. Maybe they live a real far away. Or maybe you just, you know, you don't get along and your family of origin is not necessarily the loving, fun, caring place that it was meant to be. Well, if I were to condense down what the Bible has to say about being a church family, what it's all about, I would say these three things. Number one, that we would serve and follow God together. In other words, that we would all individually and collectively seek to love God and to know God, and then to take seriously the mission that God has called us to. So to follow God and to serve Him together. The second thing would be to celebrate together. You know, when you have a baby or you get married or something, it's one thing to do that kind of in isolation. But when you do that and if you have other people, it's like, hey, that's fantastic. And they celebrate with you. The big promotion you got, you graduated from college, you got to build a new home, you got to go on the dream vacation, or you win the lottery and you give 10% to the church. And we all... we all celebrate with you. And the third thing is to face uncertainty together. And we, you know, stuff happens. Stuff happens in life. You get bad news from the doctor. You lose a loved one. You're dealing with internal, you know, conflict and problems just within yourself, externally with jobs and family. There's a lot of things that are hard in life. And we can face those uncertainties together and feel a sense of like, hey, other people care about me. They know about this and I matter to them. Did you notice that all of those have one word in common? It's the word together. Because that's what it means to be a church family, to kind of do life together. And I don't know about you, but Jana and I spend more time around and are closer to many of you than we are to the people in our own extended families. We like you more than we like some of the biological members of our family. And the three things on the screen, we've done this a whole lot more with you guys than we've done that with our family of origin. And I bet a lot of you feel the same way. Well, right now we're going to hear from a couple of people from the Seeker Church family. And the first one is newer around here. His name is Reed Huckleberry. Let's hear it for him. Come on up, Reed. Yeah. Reed and I are workout partners. He bench presses me.
He's actually pretty strong.
So, Reed, you've only been coming here for like 3 months or so now. And so, first of all, I thought I would ask you, like, How did you come? How did you hear about the church? And what do you think so far?
So right after our wedding, Chelsea and I got married last October. We decided that we wanted to find a church home. We wanted to include that into our lives, make that bigger in our children's lives. And we had been praying and searching for a church for quite a while. And one day we actually drove by out here on Barry, and I saw the Liam Neeson sign, and it just made me laugh. And I brought it up to her, and she said, you know what? My mom actually goes to church there, and I actually went there at a different location before. And I was like, well, let's try that. And it was kind of like a light bulb moment, I would say. It was kind of like God, it was a God moment where God kind of answers a prayer. And we decided we'd try it out, and we've been here ever since. It's been a good experience.
So the banner outside worked, huh?
And the promise of a free Ferrari.
Oh, yeah.
Still waiting on that.
The free Ferrari, yeah. That, if you read, you got to read the fine print on that one. So Chelsea, right over here, and is Debbie Green, who was up here speaking lately, and she did it in the building when we were down the street. And so that's Debbie's daughter, and this is Debbie's son-in-law, favorite son-in-law.
Very sweet.
Like Tanner is my favorite son-in-law, the only one I have, but he is my favorite. But anyway, so we have a few pictures here. We have, there you guys are. And your kids, go back one, Tina. This is Claire and Lane and Ace are the kids.
Lane looks really happy.
He does, yeah. He's a really good little kid, though. Now let's go to the next one. This is you guys with, I don't know, who is that guy?
That's Jeremy Camp. That's actually,
yeah.
We went and saw him a few weekends ago. We saw him here in Oklahoma City. And enjoyed the concert so much, we were like, we're going to drive to Dallas 2 days later. And we went and saw him again and got to meet him. It was actually a really good concert.
That's pretty wild. And I think we have one more. Yeah, you guys, they're all together. So I want to ask you, kind of what were your first impressions when you came here? Did you feel like people were friendly to you? Did you like the music most, the donuts the most? Was it my great jokes that kept you coming?
I would say for Lane, it was the donuts. on the jokes, maybe. Yeah. But no, it seemed very personable, very friendly. Chelsea and I have been to numerous churches where you walk in and you're just kind of a number, or you're a stranger. This never felt that way. This felt like a very happy building to be in. Everyone was very friendly, very happy. You could just feel the Holy Spirit working in the building, and it just gave us a sense of peace, and it just felt like home instantly, I would say.
Well, you know, I've always said that, you know, I've been in a big church or a small one. Big churches have, there are advantages that big churches have, and there are advantages that smaller churches have, and I'm enjoying the advantages of smaller church right now, and I really like it. And otherwise, we might not have even hardly met or anything, and we had lunch, actually, about a month ago, and talked for about an hour and a half, and I got to know Reed, and it was really great. I like who he is and what he stands for, and what I thought I'd ask you today is, in what ways are you and Chelsea and your kids beginning to feel like a part of this church family?
I think, you know, as we're beginning to serve and asking to serve and do certain things. Beginning to create relationships with people here. I feel like it's nice to have like-minded people that are trying to please God, trying to serve God. It just gives us a sense of belonging. I think it's given us a sense of peace that we didn't really know we were missing before. It's helped us in a lot of ways as far as how we raise our children, how we interact with each other. It's nice to feel excited to come to church every Sunday, and not to put down any other churches, that just wasn't always the way we felt at other places where we had that excitement. It felt like people were kind of motivated by a sense of obligation or, you know, other reasons. But for this, it's nice to wake up on Sunday mornings and feel excited to hear the message and to put it into practice each week in our daily lives.
You guys think it would help increase the offerings if he was passing the plate? I'm just wondering,
it's
you
not
know.
Enough, guys. Put more in.
All right, well, let's hear it for Reed. Thanks a lot for coming up, man. I appreciate it. All right. We have one more person that's going to come up, and most of you guys have gotten to know her over the last few years. Linda Iron. So come on up, Linda. Linda said, the thing I love most is to speak in front of a group of people.
I'm going to need help with this
Getting up on the stool? No, you're good. You're good.
Getting down is going to be
interesting. Yeah. Well, I thought I would ask you, when was the first time you came over here to this building, and what brought you over here?
Christine.
A little bit more.
Can you hear me? Okay.
I've always wanted to, tell people what to do, so.
Thank you. Christine brought me here. She actually said, hey, Mom, I ran into Russ, and I'm going to church. Would you like to come with me? Well, she had already been coming a few times, and she said, I think you should come. So I came, and it was amazing. I walked in this building, and I just felt loved. I can't explain it any other way. Everybody was so welcoming. And other than Russ, I really didn't know anybody else in the church. And I love you guys. And Christine loved Seeker Church. All I can tell you, she loved Seeker Church, and she loved you guys. And she knew that I would benefit from coming, and I have. So it's family.
Yeah, well, good. So Christine, I first met her when she was maybe 14 years old. Mm-hmm. Somebody invited her to my youth group deal. And so she started coming and became very much a part of that. What did you think when she was of her own volition choosing to go to this church thing?
I loved it. I grew up Methodist, organized church. And when I was a teenager, we had New Life, which was very similar to, I'm sure, your youth group. Mm-hmm. And I really enjoyed that. I did taper off from, as an adult, going to church, but not anymore.
Yeah, the Methodist has organized. We have disorganized religion. People say, I don't like organized religion. I said, that's good. We have disorganized religion. So, well, we have a few pictures here, and we're showing some of them here. Some of these are from...
These are all bucket list.
Bucket list.
Photos.
Trips, yeah.
So she is in Morocco.
She loved to travel.
Oh, she loved to travel, and Morocco was one of her favorite places to go. She went more than once, enchanting, basically. And so she's out on a desert trip with other people on a camel.
All right, Tina, let's see the next couple. Here she is. She was after high school, she went to medical school. She became a doctor. She delivered, I think she said to me, 3,000 babies.
That's true.
Over the years.
Yep.
She was extremely gifted as a doctor, and very, very smart. I knew it when I first met her. We did a ski trip. And one day, everybody went skiing except for her and I. I stayed back to work or do something, I can't remember, recover from my injuries. And I got to know her that day, and I thought, she is super, super sharp and just so, so nice. And so she was out, she was really living the life, she wasn't married, she could travel, she could do whatever she wanted. She touched the lives of many, many, many people.
She did.
If you read her Facebook pages and stuff, there were so many people who said, man, I can't believe that, how she affected our lives and stuff. Here's a few more pictures. She was a people person. She was very outgoing. Okay, Tina, let's see. Here you guys
that's
are.
That's lovely.
At a Thunder game, it looks like.
At a Thunder game. Yeah. We had a good time.
All right. And she...
Day of the Dead.
Yeah, she liked to do kind of crazy, weird things sometimes.
And the one on the right, she's in Brussels with Pinocchio.
Oh, really? Okay. Well, then the next one goes back to the Morocco trip.
Morocco. Mm-hmm.
She looks like she kind of fits right in there.
Right.
I saw one picture of her on a camel.
Yeah.
And so, I hadn't seen Christine for a while. And I was rehabbing my shoulder one day at the physical therapy place, and I heard my name, and I turned, and I said, Christy. She used to go by Christy, Christy, what are you doing? I'm like, what are you in for? And she said, to just real matter of fact, she said, I have terminal cancer. That's how she said it. And so I was wondering, if you wouldn't mind, sharing with people how she told you and how, as a mom, you tried to deal with that.
Well, I was with her when she was formally diagnosed. I'm going to try and make this fast. She came back from Alaska in terrible pain and whatever, and went to OU, and they did imaging and whatever and discovered the cancer. And so I went to her appointment. When she told me, she said, Mom, something's not good on this imaging, and I'm going to OU, and I'm going to go see Dr. Walker, who she trained with when she was in medical school. So I was there when they formally said, you've got ovarian cancer. I didn't realize that it was a death sentence or that it's terminal. Christine did. However, she was very hopeful all the time of new immunotherapies or treatments. She was in every study you can possibly imagine. And Dr. Walker really did save her life. So I was there from the beginning of it, and I slowly realized how serious it was. She knew how serious it was. I knew it was serious, but there's all kinds of stuff out there, right? You know? And she never gave up hope on treatments, that there'd be something. It just didn't happen within her time frame. But there is stuff out there, and you know, it will help other people.
Well, and she told me because she understood the medical side of it, mm-hmm. and now she was a person dealing with it, mm-hmm. she was asked to speak all over the country at different conferences to try to convey to these doctors, okay, I'm a doctor, but I also am experiencing this, so here is how you can better help patients that you're dealing with. And she could convey it in a normal way, but also in a more technical way for the doctors. And I think that meant a lot to her to be able to kind of feel like she was.
It was a door that opened. She had to. She couldn't practice anymore. She had neuropathy in her hands and her feet, and she said, "Mom, I can't lay hands on people with a scalpel, and I can't do that." So she became a consultant with Myriad Laboratories, which is a genetic testing company, and that she used in her practice. I mean, before she was consulting with them. So that was a new door, and she, you know, she helped people in death as well. She donated her body to OU and trained a new freshman group of medical students with anatomy. So she did a lot.
Yeah, she did. There are people here in this church who went to her because she had to kind of retire at age, 47 or something?
46. Something like that. Yeah.
46. She had to retire from this thing that she loved and was so gifted at and had spent so much time preparing for. But she was in so many of these experimental drug things that they tested on her, you know, to try to help her, but also to see. And she was just brave, as far as I could see, you know. Very brave and very willing to not allow even if something that's difficult to go to waste, you know, to help other people.
That's a good way of putting it, yeah.
Well, I wanted to ask you, so she passed away.
She's talking to you.
She's trying. You remember the time I interviewed her up here a couple of times, and the first time I cried through the whole deal. It was ridiculous. I don't like to cry in private, much less in front of other people, but she was sick for about 5 years, and she passed away at age
6 years
at age 52, yeah. Which was like just a month ago. And then this month is going to be her birthday on the 24th, is it? 24th of October. But since she passed away a couple of years ago, you have been coming here faithfully. You haven't missed. You're just a regular
couple of times,
part of, well, when you're traveling or whatever. Why have you After Christine was gone, why have you continued to be a part of
it? I love this church, and I love the people in it. And I'll tell you, I love the kids. You know, I first noticed that all of the kids, and we're talking about little up to high school, genuinely like each other, genuinely take care of each other. They were so kind to me, and I thought, these kids are great. I love this place. And that's why, I mean, not just the kids, but
sign
I'm saying.
Her, sign her up for kids' church.
I was.
Got a new volunteer, I think, that's what I'm hearing.
No, really. And that's parenting. You know, that's parenting. These wonderful kids and wonderful people in the church. I felt welcome from the very beginning. And so this is my church family. I love you guys.
Couldn't have said it better. All right. Well, thanks a lot for coming
up.
I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right. You're gonna get rid of that. Hey, look at that. Yeah. Okay. She's going
to
join the tech team, too. Okay. You got it. You got it. All right, you guys. Let's hear for Linda and Reed one more time. So I think we have on the screen here, this is God's design for our church family. And we do all of these things together. Now we're going to do in the service like we have been lately by having the band come back up. We're going to do We Are Family one more time. And our theme song for today. And only it's like song's 3 minutes. So if you need to get out of here quick to watch the kickoff of the whatever game, you know. You'll be forgiven, but the band won't forgive you if you leave. No, if you got to take off, feel free to do that. But just remain seated. We'll have our closing prayer, and then these guys will play the song, and you guys can all take off. Lord, many of us here feel like this church family is a really big part, an important part of our lives. We love our regular family, our biological family, our family by marriage and different things mean a lot to us. And Lord, this means a lot to us also. For us, this is a place where we feel wanted and we belong and we matter and we know other people care about us. We care about them. Lord, we're thankful for what we are experiencing and enjoying in this church right now. And I pray, God, as we go forward, we would remember the things that we've talked about today and the things that Reed and Linda have shared with us, and that we would be the kind of church family that truly is together in these ways that are important. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Slideshow one more time, too, I think.